Listen, let me just start real quick with that and just say, so on Friday, Kim Knox and I, on behalf of our board, authorized by them, finalized the close of our Midtown building. And so that is officially sold, and we're grateful to God for that. And that was awesome, and grateful for the sale of that, which those proceeds will help us continue to move forward. So we're grateful for that as well. They're going to be the hands of good owners. We got 7 days to move out, so we're going to be busy this week. And so if you want to come help out with that anyway, you can contact the church office and help us out. But we're going to get moved out. We're just about done. There's a big estate sale, so we did a lot during that. If there's some things that you want, you go right ahead. Just let us know. At this time, we'll take an offer. You just take what you want. We're going to work that through her, and then we'll go from there. We started, We started our all-in series several weeks ago, and I want to not bring it necessarily to a close, but I'm going to finish kind of the message portion next week. It's going to be a really special time for us together as we finish up next week on Commitment Sunday. So today I want to talk with you then. We started with this all-in journey, and we talked about some principles, and let me just do a quick review because I would like to make sure we're building. We talked about this first principle is when it comes to following God's plan, there is no plan B. Somebody say amen right there. That's a good amen. There is no plan B. Here's the second principle, that God is not trying to get something from you. God desires to get something to you. God desires to get something to you. Not trying to get something from you. He's trying to get something to you. And then we determined that why we talked about why All In was our theme was because it was going to take that kind of commitment required that he was challenging our church in three specific areas that he wanted us in the next season to have bigger faith, increase, believe him to have bigger faith than where we're at, a challenge, a faith challenge, to have a stronger ministry impact. And even more so, I get more and more convicted and convinced about those opportunities, having stronger ministry impact and letting the Lord frame that. No church is everything, but we have to be everything God called us to be. Somebody there, you good there? And so here's this next one, then greater, someone, there's that word, opportunity, say opportunity. Greater, are we enthused? Are we okay? Are we good? Are we good? Let me know if my breath is bad. Let me know if that's what it is. Greater opportunity. Opportunity. And so I'm going to talk to you about some of that even today. Then we talked about these five pillars, and that's where I've been building the messages. And so we identified four of them so far. We started with, the first one was surrender. We talked about, the second one was trust. Who can remember the third one? What was the third one? What was that third one? Generosity was that third one. What was the fourth one? Sacrifice was that for a good job. Look at you all. Okay, so we were there. So, and then we identified this. Last week, we then said we had three specific goals over the next 2 years. Over the next 48 months, we had three specific goals that we were looking at. We had a primary goal, and that primary goal was 100% participation. We want every person to participate at whatever level so that you can grow. And so we said that's going to take surrender and trust. And then we said we had an impact goal. And that's the impact goal is what it takes to do ministry for us here at the church, what it takes to lights and salaries and buildings and those things, the things that God has blessed us with that as a first-gen church are what we bear in moving forward so we set up the next generation. And so our impact goal to function is 1.1. And then we set our opportunity goal, and that was how we're going to look at, hey, Lord, what was another tool that we want to be able to acquire? And that was the $700,000 that we talked about was the sacrifice. Those were the basics of what I laid out last week. So today I want to start. Did you know in 1856, there was a man named Henry Brown. Someone say Henry Brown. Henry Brown was a slave in Richmond, Virginia, who decided he didn't want to be a slave anymore. So Henry found himself a box, actually a wooden crate, a small wooden crate, and he postmarked it to an abolitionist he had heard about in Philadelphia, which was free territory at that time. So Henry got inside of the wooden crate and he sealed it from the inside, and Henry Brown actually mailed himself to Philadelphia. The crate was delivered to that abolitionist, and when he opened it, Henry carefully stood up after being in that box for 3 weeks. How do you do, sir? My name is Henry Brown, and I was a slave. And I heard something about you being an abolitionist, and so I'm entrusting my future to you. Henry Brown took a huge risk. It was an oxygen risk. It was an injury risk. It was a risk of going hungry. It was a risk of being discovered. But Henry Brown stood up in that crate in Philadelphia as a free man. Henry Brown rejoiced as a free man because his commitment to freedom outweighed the cost of inconvenience. Church, this is where I want to talk about this fifth pillar of All In, and it is this word called commitment. And what I want you to understand is these five things, these five pillars that we've talked about are not just about a campaign. I've been talking to you about life. Anybody realize I've been talking about life? That as you grow in your relationship with the Lord, it's those same, those pillars are something I chose to identify here to illustrate this, but these are things that you will take, that it's gonna take for you to grow. It's gonna take surrender. It's gonna take trust. It's gonna take generosity. It's gonna take sacrifice, and it surely is gonna say commitment. Someone say commitment with me. I wanna talk to you about something the Lord showed me this week about commitment, and I feel like I got a different insight about it. Turn to Luke chapter 5 if you have your Bibles or on your phones. Luke chapter 5, starting in verse 1. I'm reading out of the NIV, those of you who want to be exactly in the version that I'm in. Luke chapter 5, starting at verse 1. One day as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats. Now, I want to be clear. What did we already read? That they were crowded around him and listening to the word of God. So he's already teaching, right? Are we good there? Am I misinterpreting? Are we good? My English folks, are we good? Okay. All right. So he's already teaching. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon. Who is Simon? What's his name? What's his other name we end up knowing him by in Scripture? Peter, yeah, you talk to me. It's good. We're okay. We're talking church. We're good. You talk out. If you don't, the babies will. We talk to Peter, right? Okay, so Peter, stay with me. All right, so he got Peter's boat and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. Can I just ask you one more question? He was already teaching and already had a crowd. Did you ever think he's already teaching, he already has a crowd, but he notices these guys and he goes and he got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Peter. And he said, push out, and he taught some more. Did you ever think that maybe him getting in the boat was more about Peter than it was about teaching? Hold that thought. Let's keep going. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the water and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answered, Master, we have worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I'll let down my nets. And when they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. And so they signaled their partners in the boat, in the other boat, to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full they began to sink. Here's the third principle I want to talk to you about. You cannot make convenience a priority when commitment is required to accomplish your goal. You can't make convenience your priority when it's going to take commitment to accomplish your goal. It's not convenient to do right, but when that accomplishes your goal, you make that the priority. It takes commitment to get where you want to go. You can't make convenience your priority. The Andam family were a Filipino family that I became really good friends with their sons in high school in Los Angeles. The Andams were, if you know, the Philippines, there are different sections, different ones, and then the Andams were known as Ilocanos. They were the people of the mountains, and they are the darker-skinned Filipinos. And so if you've ever been to the Philippines, there's a range of shades. And so the ones in the mountains are darker-skinned, and the Andams and I were really, really close. What's amazing then is when the Andams talk about when they came from the Philippines, the mom and the dad came first. And the mom and the dad came, and they wanted to make sure they bought a house before they sent for the children. Actually, Mr. Andam came over first before he sent for his wife. Mr. Andam worked as a janitor, a custodian at Kaiser Permanente Hospital. He worked there for 1 year. He had a goal. He wanted to get his wife over so they could be in, buy a home, and then he could have children. And so Mr. Andam, for a year, as he was the custodian that just cleaned the hospital, ate one meal for every meal for a year. He had rice and he ate chicken backs. What are chicken backs? Not the meat. He ate the skin every meal for a year so that he could save up to buy a home and to get his wife over so they could begin to have their family. Now, how many of us get bored? Like, we go to a restaurant one time, and we like, I ain't having that no more. Like, one thing, you know, Mr. Andam, I remember him talking about the rice and those chicken backs. And when I realized he didn't even, like, I was thinking, well, the back of the chicken, like, little meat. No meat. He just ate the skins. He'd cook them up, and he would cut them up, and he would eat those with the rice for a year. And now Mr. Andam and Mrs. Andam have a house right along on a major street in Los Angeles. Their house is probably worth millions because of its location. And they bought it with barely want to sell it to them. They didn't even see a value in it. But Mr. Andam now is in one of the most highly sought after areas and neighborhoods in Los Angeles. He has two sons, Errol and Eric. They had a third son. The first son, their third one was actually their first son, and he actually died. He was a baby when he died. The Andams and I got really, really close. Well, they finally told the story about this baby that they had that died, and the Andams adopted me into their family. I mean, they were sweet people. So one day we were talking about this son of theirs that had died, and finally the Andams told me that the son was born on August 4th, 1971. I'll give you three guesses. Two of them don't count what day I was born on. August 4th, 1971. The Andam said, we knew the Lord would give us our son back somehow. Can you hear me? Can I tell you about Mr. Andam, who didn't even go to college, but who ate chicken backs and rice because he was, what's that word, committed. It wasn't convenient to do that, but he was committed. He had a goal, and he reached his goal. You cannot make convenience a priority when commitment is required to get there. Here's this next principle, that commitment is fueled from an internal strength, not external circumstances. Somebody say amen right there. It's fueled by internal strength, not external circumstances. Something, when you're committed, it originates and it's got its strength from in here. You're not going to get it from getting and taking surveys of people. Committed says it's right here. Committed says, I don't care what anybody thinks. Here's the vision I've got. This is inside of me. And it's so much inside of you, it oozes out of you. You can't even help it. The strength of commitment starts on the inside. It's never from the outside. Commitment is the cost of true transformation. That's the next one in your notes. That commitment is the cost of true transformation. You don't have anything really change until you commit to it. Nothing changes. A culture doesn't change until you commit to it. We had a desire back in 2017, we had a commitment. We wanted to help change the culture of our school district. We had to get committed. And one of the things that brought about commitment was we had to realize what was the cost of transformation. The first place we started is we said, we are going to be a data-based decision-making organization. What did that mean? We were going to move from feeling like to having evidence of. And we were going to make decisions that were in spite of our feelings, because we all had our prejudices and all had our priorities. But how many know opinions don't change things? And so committed, the cost of transformation. So the cost of transformation, because you got to know that you've got real things you're standing on, because when you got to make tough decisions, somebody say tough decisions. Yeah, that's not in your notes, but that's a free point. That commitment will lead you to make tough decisions. Everybody's not doing this when you're committed. Everybody's not doing this when you're committed. They eventually will do that, but there's a whole long time that all they're doing is spitting in your direction, and you're trying to avoid being spat on because you're committed. Because you realize commitment gives you vision. That's the other one that's not in your notes. Commitment comes from a place of vision. You can see it when they can't. You believe it when they don't. You hear it when they can't. And you will not be moved from it because you are fully committed to being committed. And so it's why, if you look at the Bible, every time there was a change in leadership, you don't see the Lord necessarily saying, Joshua, listen, I need you to pray more and sing more songs. No, you know what he told him? Joshua, you be strong and courageous. Joshua, be very strong and courageous. Here's what he wanted us to know, that if you want to be a game changer, if you want to be a life impactor, if you want to have God kind of impact, church, you have got to stop being cowards. You have got to start being strong and courageous. Strong and courageous says, you may not understand, you may not get it, but I'm committed to what God wants. And if that just means it's just me, then it's just gonna have to be just me. Committed, I'm gonna make good decisions, because that's what it costs. It costs a transformation. It's commitment, it's the cost of transformation. Well, to transform your body, it's gonna take commitment. You want to transform your mindset through education? It's going to take a, church, we should have this by now. It's going to take what, a what? Commitment. Yeah, it's going to take a commitment. Yeah. Yeah, you want to transform a community through seeing what they don't see, blessing it instead of cursing it, having a vision, sowing in it instead of always taking from it. You're going to have to be, Oh yeah, you want to achieve something that nobody in your family has achieved? You're going to have to speak to it every day. That's going to take, yeah. We want our children to do well. We're going to have to give them a time. Yeah. You want your relationship to work? You're going to have a love. Oh yeah, real stuff. Commitment, the cost of transformation. Here's this next one. Commitment is the outward expression and declaration of faith. Commitment is the outward expression and declaration of faith. It's why we talk about baptism. It's why it's important that every believer is baptized. It doesn't save you, but it is the outward expression and declaration of faith. Baptism says, I am committed. Yeah. This right here is my outward expression of declaration and faith. This does not make me married. This does say I am. It's supposed to be a beacon. I'm committed. Anybody not part of that, it should say stay away. Because he's committed to you. It should let you know they're committed off the trading block. Committed. All of it. Is this making sense yet? Is it? Are we good? And so here's where we go then. Then Matthew, then 14. Remember that statement. Where's that statement? Remember I talked about Jesus. Now remember we said Jesus was already teaching. Is that right? Say with me. Jesus was already teaching, already had a crowd. But he all of a sudden sees these two fishermen. He goes and gets on the boat. Whose boat did he get on again? Let's go then. Here's Matthew 14. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the water on the lake. This is, again, this is famous where Jesus is walking on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage. Didn't say, keep praying. First thing he says, it's me. Take courage. I don't know when you're going to get it, but it's going to take courage to walk this out. It's going to take courage to live this kind of life. But anyway, just keep going. That's not the message. That's a different one. He says, it is I. Don't be afraid. Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Jesus said, come. Then Peter got out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. Now, if you know the rest of the story, he begins to look to the storms and he sings, but I just want to get to this. I want to stop right here. I'm not preaching a partial gospel. I got somewhere I'm going. Then Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. And then it hit me. Peter had the courage to step out of the boat because Jesus was first showed commitment to step onto his boat. And church, here's the crazy part. Here's where it almost will bring tears to your eyes. Some of us have not identified where the Lord intentionally stepped on your boat so that one day you would have the courage to step out of a boat. Some of us are waiting and want that moment, but you've got to get back and remember when he intentionally stepped on your boat so that one day you will have the courage to step out of the boat you may currently be in. Jesus was already teaching. He already had a crowd. There was no reason for Jesus to go and step on that boat except for one reason. If I remember it, as a kid, I think we used to say, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. I know that Jesus, because the Bible tells me so. I want you to see that his commitment was already there. Church, there's some of us that are looking, wondering, waiting, but I'm telling you, you got to remember when the Lord stepped in your boat on purpose to give you the courage to step out of the boat you're currently in. So here's this last one. Commitment involves a risk that will result in multiplication. Yeah. Involves a risk that's going to result in multiplication. Because even though we read the story and Peter sank in the water, he multiplied. He grew from that experience. He learned the Lord will be there for him. He multiplied. He didn't just grow. He multiplied. And he became a multiplier. Does anybody remember on the day of Pentecost, which disciple gave the message that 3,000 people came? I don't know what he preached, but I have an instinct. He may have talked about when he was out walking on the water and he found the Savior. The reason he knows that Jesus saves lives is because before he ever got to the cross, Peter said, he saved my life. Church, I'm encouraging you. You got to find where Jesus intentionally stepped on your boat and encouraged you to push out. And the only reason he did it, he didn't need one thing from you. He wasn't trying to get anything from them. He didn't need transportation. He didn't need fish. He didn't need a place to teach. He didn't need a bigger crowd. So why does he get on the boat? Because he loves Peter. And one day, Peter's gonna get out of the boat because Jesus dared to get on his boat. And he believes that same thing about you, that you're gonna remember when he stepped on your boat for no other reason except that he loves you. And he wants to empower you with the courage to step out. Is anybody hearing me this morning? Is this making sense at all, or was this just craziness in my head? So right where you are, would you just take a moment and would you just think, you got all day to be busy, but would you think about maybe a place where the Lord stepped on your boat? It looks different for all of us. Stepping on your boat may have looked like he took you out of a bad situation. And you keep wondering, like, Lord, then why did you, because I should have been caught. That should have gone really bad for me. And you keep wondering why he did it. And you're grateful like you didn't get caught, but what you don't realize is he stepped on your boat so that one day you'll step out of the boat you're in. Sometimes him stepping on your boat looks like somebody giving you an opportunity that out of a whole crowd of people, they picked you. A whole group of applicants, they picked you. Other people should have got the promotion, but you got it. It was the Lord stepping on your boat so that one day you'll step out of the boat you're in. Church, hear me. I need you to think about it. I need you to, if you can't find it today, I'm asking, it's your homework for the next week. Lord, when did you step on my boat? Lord, I need to know, because that's going to be my inspiration for stepping out when you say, come on. Because you know he's faithful.